Oh, Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We are indeed thankful for this opportunity here this evening. And Father, we ask, help us to redeem the time. Please strengthen us and help us, dear God, not to waste time, but please help us that we will go forward and spread your message to a dying world, that we will pray more, study more. Please help us mental, spiritual, and physical preparation, because we need it for such a time as this. Please, Father, we pray for your Holy Spirit to fall upon us and Sister Madison at this time as she deliver the message. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Excuse me, just one quick moment, please. Alrighty, so tonight we are going to study the Bible about something musical. Finally, we're going to let a little bit of our stuff from the morning kind of drip down into these evening devotions. At least for today, it's music theme. I was studying this yesterday and I was like, wow, this is really precious what God is sharing with me. So I wanted to share it with you all. And it is about contemporary music, Christian contemporary music. And I've experienced a wide range of outlooks and emotions on this topic. It is a very charged word in Seventh-day Adventism. Maybe you feel very passionate about it. It's really important to the worship experience. Maybe you think it's vital to attracting the young people and attracting people to hear the gospel message. Or maybe on the other hand, you feel like, oh man, this is really not what should be played from the pulpit. This is exactly what is going to have us deceived and carried away, and it's bringing in other influences. There's a lot. As I said, it's a very charged subject. But in all of our human emotions and ideas and feelings, it's a blessing that we don't have to carry the burden of this topic on our shoulders as if God didn't exist, as if God doesn't have anything to say about the music that we listen to, about the music that maybe we enjoy or maybe we don't enjoy. So, in its most literal sense, contemporary music, well, the word contemporary, according to I believe the Merriam-Webster dictionary, means marked by characteristics of the present period. Other word or synonyms that you could replace it with would be modern or current. So you could call it current music or modern music. And did you know that there actually is a type of modern music that God wants to hear? We can read about it in our Bible, so I hope you all have your Bibles with you. We can now turn to Psalm 33. Psalm chapter 33. And that's going to be verses 2 and 3. Could you read that, please, Sister Ordet, Miss Ordet, Psalm 33, verses 2 and 3.
Okay, I'll read. Praise the Lord with harp, sing unto him with the psaltery
Yeah.
and an instrument of 10 strings. Sing unto him a new song. Play skillfully with a loud noise.
Oh dear, I was on mute again and reading.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'll let you. I have another one coming up in just a second. You can read that. But thank you, Sister Kim. So this morning in our music class, we talked about how it's a beautiful thing to have a lot of instruments working together, and the way that works together can remind us of what heaven will be like. So music that has a lot of different instruments and complexity to it, can be really beautiful and pleasing to God, because that's all I'm saying right here. You know, we want to praise him with an instrument of strings, with the psaltery, with the harp, and with our voices, right? We see harmony in verse 2. And then in verse 3, it says, sing unto him a new song. This is a song that is not old, it's new, it's current, it is relevant to our time. So we find that we are encouraged to sing a new song to the Lord. Sister Odette, you can, with your mic unmuted, please read for us Isaiah chapter 42. That's Isaiah 42, verses 9 and 10.
Okay, I can read.
Yes, thank you.
Behold, the form of things that come to pass, and new things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. Sing unto the Lord a new song, and his praise from the end of the earth. Ye that go down into the sea, and all that is therein, the isles and the inhabitants thereof.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Casey. Yes, and so God alone has power to tell us new things before they even spring forth, before they come to pass. And God wants to continually show us new wonders, new things that really, in a literal sense, I guess you would say it's new, but principally speaking, we know that God doesn't change, but he wants us to have a new experience. As we have these new experiences with the Lord and grow in our faith, he wants us to sing new songs that come from a renewed heart that has been changed by his working. And these are songs of praise, right? So, new songs can be quite a blessing. We don't just have to listen to old songs all the time. But while we may enjoy new songs of praise to God, we have to still remember that the one who we worship, however, is not changing. He never has changed. He never will. I'm going to go to Malachi, the book of Malachi, chapter 3, in verse 6. And I'll read this one. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6 says, For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed. God's mercy never fails, it never changes. But even though he's merciful, he has a whole spectrum of different attributes that the Bible describes his character. He is mercy, absolutely. But as we study the Word of God, we find so many other things about him. We find that he's merciful, but he's just, he's long-suffering, he's abundant in goodness and truth, he's faithful, right? He's holy, he's pure, he's our God only wise. He's all of these things. And these attributes of his character are never going to change. When we get to heaven, the God that we read about in the Bible and that we've gotten to know through our Christian experience is going to be the same God that we meet when we finally get to see his face. So we have to remember that God is never going to change. Our songs may be new, but the one who we are worshiping and the one who we're praising is not going to change. The things that he stood for that were important to him in the Bible are still important to him today. The Bible warns us about some who will try to preach to us a new character of God or a new gospel, a new way to be saved. And whereas God wants us to make a new song, God does not want us to accept this new gospel. So let's have somebody please read that for me in Galatians chapter 1. Welcome, Sister Lily. Good to see you. Are you able to read Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 and 8?
Galatians?
Galatians with a G. That's Galatians 1, verses 6 through 8. And welcome, Sister Pompey. Just so you all know, we are studying about contemporary music to find out what God has to say about our music and our songs.
Okay, Galatians chapter 1, verse.
Galatians, Sister. Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 and 7.
67. I marvel that ye are so removed from him. Is that the one?
Yes, that's it.
Okay. I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that calls you unto the grace of Christ, unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and you prevent the gospel of Christ. Perfect.
Yes, and you can read verse 8 too, actually.
Okay. But though we or an angel from heaven preach other gospel unto you than which we have preached unto you, let them be accursed.
Thank you. That's very solemn. And the thing is, if there would be some who would deceive God's faithful would-be Christians in that day, I know it must be true of our day as well, because Jesus told us that in the last days, there would be false prophets, there would be false Christs. And if Jesus didn't shorten those days of trouble ahead of us, that there would be no one saved, because the deceptions are just so subtle and so crafty. It's really a terrible thing. So as our Sister Lily just read in Galatians, we do not want to be carried about with a so-called another gospel, because it's really not another gospel. There's only one gospel, and that can be found in Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. It is salvation, righteousness by faith, and Jesus Christ alone. He is our Savior, and the way in which he saves us is clearly spelled out for us in the Bible. That is the gospel, and that is what our hope and our music must be founded on. So, new songs? Absolutely. New gospel? Absolutely not. We don't want to do that. So, how can we beware as we listen to our new or modern or contemporary music to not accept with the music also a new gospel? Bear with me. We are going to go over 5 points that we can ask ourselves when we listen to new music. Is this also a new gospel, or is it the time and true, time-tested gospel of Jesus Christ put in a new and living melody or expression? All right. So question number one that we can always ask ourselves, is this song true? Now, can I have someone please read John chapter 17, verse 17?
I'll read.
Okay, thank you. John 17, verse 17.
Sanctify him. True by word is true. John chapter 17, verse 17.
Amen. Thank you, Casey Lee. It kind of reminds me of that scripture song that you shared. God's word. God's word is what quickens us and it sanctifies us too. So, is it true? It seems like an obvious question to ask. Like, we shouldn't have to ask ourselves that, right? But it's interesting how there are some Christian songs that have become popular in our time and in our day that they seem so nice and they're fun to sing, but sometimes they say things that are like not biblically factual. So just always be asking yourself, is it true? Is it according to the Bible account? Or are they adding things into the storyline of our Old Testament and New Testament Bible stories that didn't actually happen? Or maybe they don't even talk about Bible facts at all. Maybe it's just about feeling this and feeling that, and it doesn't really even teach us anything true from the Bible. So how can we, again, be mindful of this? I would say be very familiar with your Old and New Testament Bible stories. Study them, search them out, and know the scriptures for yourself. That way, when you're listening to a song and you hear something that is said, you'll know, oh, wait, that's not true. The Bible says this, but they're singing that. Or the Bible teaches this, but this song is teaching something else. Maybe I shouldn't be listening to this. All right, our point number two, does this song teach what is right? Can somebody please read us Isaiah 8, verse 20?
I can say it.
Okay, go right ahead. Isaiah 8, verse 20.
To the law and to the testimony, if they speak but according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
Yes, wonderful. Did you have that memorized by any chance?
Yeah, it from my head.
Praise the Lord. That was right. Quick. She said, I know what this one is. And that's wonderful. This is the type of mind that God wants us to have, to be able to, you know, and it's not through our own strength that we're going to be able to pick out these false doctrines and false gospels, but Jesus promised that if we hide it in our hearts, the Holy Spirit will bring these things to our mind when the devil would try to lead us astray. So praise the Lord. Let's indeed continue to memorize our scriptures. Does this song teach what is right? Well, first of all, we need to understand what is right. The book of Psalms, chapter 19, tells us that the statutes of the Lord are right. And God's statutes, that word also basically means precepts, his teachings, his commandments. It's his law, but even more broadly speaking than his law, it's his principles, it's his teachings. Like, it makes me think of Jesus instructing the people on the Sermon on the Mount, or the apostles sending letters of instruction to the different churches, right? These are Christian precepts, and we need to know them. Because in our music, our contemporary music should teach things that are right, things that are biblical principles are biblically sound. For instance, Sunday worship is becoming a more, not that it hasn't been popular, but in the music, you may come across a lot of contemporary music that is promoting Sunday worship. We know clearly that's not in accordance with God's holy precepts. That's clearly not in the law of the Ten Commandments. Another thing that is sweeping through the music is something that we might not necessarily see as blaringly in the Ten Commandments, but I find it a lot in the book of First Peter. It talks about how In order to overcome sin in our lives, we have to be willing to suffer with Jesus and gain that victory and live that new life, even as he walked. He didn't have a cookie cutter, easy life. He had a life of suffering, but it was worth it. This theme can be seen in, like I said, the writings of the Apostle Peter in the book of 1 Peter, but it's all throughout the Gospels. This is an essential precept to Christianity, but yet in a lot of contemporary music, it's about having, you know, good feelings and a good life. And yes, God does want us to be happy, but this cannot be our guiding star. The guiding star must be to be like Jesus, to be with him where he is, to be changed. We can't put the cart before the horse. We can't put good fun, good feelings, and just having a good time above maybe those times he may call us to suffer, or we need to actually get victory over our bad habits in our lives. These are things that the music that we're listening to should reflect. It should teach us what is right and what is true about the Christian religion. So again, I would encourage you, study your Bibles. Study some good places to start if you want to learn about God's precepts are the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20. There's also the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5 through 7. And many of the epistles to the churches of those days are full of precepts and instructions that can guide us as we choose our music. And our time is about running out, so I may have to stop on point number three. But the next question we can ask ourselves is this song pure? Philippians 4:8 tells us that we should think about things that are pure, things are lovely, things that are of good report. And it's kind of crazy to think that you can have a song that is a Christian song, but yet not pure. Like, that doesn't even make sense. But again, we have to be on guard against many of the deceptions that are going to come to us in the last days, because you would expect if it's a Christian song, it must be pure. But a lot of musicians are coming out of a lifestyle that is not pure, the secular music industry, and crossing over into this Christian realm, producing music, not so much to help people to change, but because it's very profitable and it makes a lot of money. And so those things that are connected with the lifestyle that are obviously impure makes us think about like parties and dancing and drinking and such. We obviously wouldn't listen to that type of music, but it through a lot of different artists that are not genuine in crossing over into this category are carrying with that the same types of music. The words may change, but the music is still made to fit this purpose and to create this mood that goes along with an impure lifestyle. So our music, even without the words, should reflect things that are uplifting, holy, heavenward, that are going to make us to want to be more like Jesus. So I have a few more points, but I also have something else that I have to go to in a few minutes, so I will have to stop here. But I pray that you all were blessed by these scriptures. Does anyone have any questions or comments before we pray and close here?
Yes, so this is very important for the young people as they make their music, and I pray that they listen to it even though they are not here, and they will be able to make it to the next one. You know, that you will continue where you will continue the other points, but it's very, very important. I was listening one time. There is something they called, this is something worldly, mindfulness. And they're trying to teach people mindfulness, you know, but that's all within themselves. You know, that has nothing to do with Christ. But we need to do everything, you know, with our minds on Christ and put everything through Christ's sieve before we accept or reject it. Thank you so much.
Yes, praise the Lord. Okay, well, if no one else has anything, I will go ahead and close this with a word of prayer. And thank you to all of you who participated reading scriptures and sharing different thoughts. Really appreciate it, and hopefully we should be able to continue this next Monday. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for your word. And thank you for caring about music, which is such an integral part, Lord, to our daily lives, to our culture, to just so much about us, Lord. And you know how powerful music is. So please don't leave us in this area. Just like we need you to teach us what to eat and how to dress and how to spend our time every day, Lord, how to study. We need you to teach us what type of music we should listen to so that we can be very careful, as Jesus told us to be, against the deceptions of the last days. Please guard our minds and bring us closer to you through the music we listen to, please. Please forgive us of our sins and hear our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.